Socially radical. Socially radical. Socially. Socially Radical Guitarist. Song you heard just now was 99 from the artist Black Ant. And actually, Black Ant is here with us today to discuss. We flirted with it a little bit with Polar Jenny, and now we're going to get really into that alternative electronic music. But first, we're going to be doing the disclaimer. Anything that I say or anything that my guests say on the show are the respective opinions of the host and the guests. They have nothing to do with Radio Waterloo, any of its subsidiaries, or any of its affiliates. So, no, you can't sue public radio over this program. And while the African and Caribbean Inclusion Center is sponsoring this show, the respective opinions of the host and the guests are the opinions of the host and the guest only. They have nothing to do with the African and Caribbean Inclusion Center either. So don't sue the nonprofit either. Support the nonprofit, especially consider supporting their drive for full inclusion, full integration, and full equality. If you want to learn more about that, you can go to the contact page of the Socially Radical Guitarist website. And if you value this show, if you want to hear the truth, if you're tired of being sanitized with mainstream news that just lies to you on a regular basis and you want to hear the truth, support this show, because the show is the show of the people, and it'll only be brought up by the people. So please support this show by going to the contact page and either clicking the Bitcoin donate button or the PayPal donate button. Here or here, the ones highlighted in white. All right, so Black Ant is here. He's going to talk about, the track that just played, the track that's going to play. I'm just going to ask him a simple question. Black Ant, where are you? Where did you grow up? Yeah, so where do you live and where did you grow up? What's your upbringing? Just
tell us where you are. All right, so like I was actually like born in New York, and then after like the first 2 years, we moved to like South Florida, like around Miami and stuff like that. And then somewhere close to like when I'm like 10 years old, we moved to Hollywood, Florida, which is just about like 30 minutes north of Miami. And that's where I really like do like the real growing and development and stuff like that, because I don't leave until like I'm like in my like early 20s, right? And it's down there once I start making music. Right now, it's a long story, but I'm in Pittsburgh and I'm getting the hell out pretty damn soon. it's either going to be like, it's looking like I'm moving to California after this crap. So that's where I'm at.
Oh, that's kind of crazy, because when I looked at your profile, you had a Haiti flag. You were flying the Haiti
flag. Oh, okay. Flag. Is that where
you're
my family, yeah. My family, like, I'm first generation American. And then, you know, being first generation, you're still like mostly Haitian, right? So I always kind of just identify myself Haitian first, you know, like that's just how it is at home, family. My first words were in Creole. So, you know what I'm saying? So like I had to kind of become American, you know. Now I finally think in English, you know what I'm trying to say? So that type of stuff, yeah.
Well, we have a radical political perspective on whether an African can become an American. But, you know.
Yeah, right.
That is another topic for another time. Now, how did you start playing music?
Man, So I can't even really remember it, but like we always had like my dad one day, it had to have been my dad. We had like a keyboard or whatever, like, and I remember just kind of playing with it like 4 or 5 years old. I don't know what the hell I'm doing, but I like that when I do something, I get something back. So then a few years later, he buys me like a guitar, and I'm like 8 years old. Still same thing. I don't really know what I'm doing, but I know like there's like, well, when I do this, I like that. When I do that afterwards, I don't really like it. So you're getting that, you know, that feedback. And then, so I'm 8 years old, and finally about like 12, 11 years old, I'm like in the band at school. Now this is when it gets a little bit serious. So I play the trumpet. I thought it was going to be Miles Davis, whatever, not really. But it gives me the background to learn how to read notes and stuff like that. And I start getting an idea. So I'm like, oh, now I know I can read it. Like I have more autonomy in that sense. And then the following year, I drop out of band because I was like, I got tired of carrying the trumpet and stuff like that. And I was the only kid in my class in band. So that was the whole like, that whole like social stigma in a way. In that sense. And so then after that year, I start making beats. I had like a homeboy, and we were gonna rap together, we're gonna be rappers, whatever. And he's just like chilling one day. He's like, bro, you gotta make beats because we're gonna get sued. We can't rap on other people's beats. We're like 13, 14 years old, like, you know, like who the hell is gonna really know? But that's it. And then I start making beats, and I just didn't stop.
That's great. Now, so you made beats, just thought about making beats. Was there any particular influence that made you want to make short alternative hip hop beats like that? Or?
Oh, so many. And around the time, you know, this is like, so I'm 30 years old right now. When I started like 13, 14, it was like 2004, 2005. So there's a lot of good stuff coming out in terms of like, you know, you have Just Blaze, you got Timbaland, you got Pharrell, Neptunes, you know. And then even before that, my first real introduction to hip hop, my pops, he had like the Columbia Music House subscription. So he didn't know what the hell he was getting. You know, my dad's from Haiti, whatever. He's just like, oh, yeah, it's a lot of music. And then I'm going to be tapped into the culture. So he's just getting all types of stuff. So he eventually gets like that first ODB record, the Return to the 36. And that's like my first introduction to hip hop. And that first intro, you know, there's just like, you know, it's RZA on the beats. And like, it's just very like creepy and dark, but it's still like really cool and hard, right? And I remember it gave me some anxiety initially when I was a kid. Like, I remember like it scared the shit out of me. Like, cause the sound was the sounds that you kind of hear in horror movies in a way. And I also remember, like, and then right off the bat, like, you know, ODB starts cursing like a motherfucker. Hey, can I curse on here? My bad.
No problem. Okay. So we did the disclaimer for a reason. Don't worry.
Okay. I'll keep it down. So he starts cursing and my mom's rushing out like, yo, you know, like you can't let him hear that because I'm 4 years old. But that's like, I'm like, oh, okay. So here's this thing. It's kind of cool, but it's scary. And my mom is like not with it. So it's like crazy. I'm now more interested, you know? So then that sound was always like in my mind in a way, you know what I'm saying? So yeah. RZA's like that first like foundation for me in terms of like what I kind of wanted to do. And then everything else after that, I mean, like if you're into anime, the Samurai Champloo, you know, all those guys were making really good beats, all four of them, like from those like different, like, you know, soundtracks, you know, just like that. Yeah. And then playing video games as well, you're hearing all those little noises and whatever, all the background sounds and all the different things that are going on. So when you just start kind of like, you know, it's like a centrifuge. All these different ideas and inspirations, they keep spinning. And then when you hit that stop, you get this new thing. You get this new structure, you know? It's just like this aggregate structure. And that's what I became, you know?
Wow. Yeah. I'm glad that you were thinking about new jabs, because that is the first thing I thought of when I heard your music.
Tight.
So, yeah, tight. Yeah. So now I know for sure, but I always suspected, you know, you might have listened to it a little bit. So is there a story behind the song 99, like the one that just played?
I'm not exactly sure why I called it 99. I think the way it sounded, so it kind of sounded 99. But like that guitar sample is really me. So I, that same buddy that got me into making beats, we also had a noise band. We called it Crack Hotel. And I actually sampled myself playing guitar in that and then just moved it around some. And then I was like, oh, this loops, this sounds crazy. And, just sounds wild. Like, that one sounds real creepy. Like, it's kind of like what I heard, what I felt when I listened to like ODB, like 4 years old. It's just like this weird ass, like, what is that? And so yeah, that's like that came from me playing like guitar. Yeah,
it's kind of crazy that you wrote that with the guitar. It'd be hard to believe for anybody just listening, but if you have that musical background, you can kind of hear it. You know, as guests, we always give two tracks. Musical guests always get two tracks. And I was just wondering about, you know, the song that's coming up next, Arch Pigeon Coop. I actually couldn't find this one on Spotify. Is this one, yes, one just a new single?
It's old. A lot of my, funny enough, bro, a lot of my music is old as hell. Like I'm kind of telling the story backwards. So like the 99, that was like, I made that in 2010. And then the Pigeon Coop, that's actually from 2009. And that again is me playing guitar. And then I cut a sample. Basically like a lot of them, like I'll just like, you know, once again, my dad bought like my first like Fender Strat. He's actually a big like contributor to like the Black Ant Enterprises, and he doesn't realize it. But so yeah, I just kind of, you know, I just jam out whatever, and then like you find a spot that sounds really good and you keep looping it, and then, you know what, let me toss some drums on that too. So the Pigeon Coop, like there's like a Jay Dilla beat, I believe, called like Smokey in the Pigeon Coop, something like that. So that's where that really kind of came from. But that beat itself, like I usually just give it to friends to rap over. Just yesterday, I think I shared one, Jamon Creek. He's like the fifth rapper in like 12 years or 13 years to get on that. So like, you know, like the funky drummer drum loop, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm trying to turn that beat into that. Just get like, you know, like bunch of different rappers, like just to like, oh yeah, that's the history. So then that beat itself has a life of its own, right? Yeah. But no, it's not on Spotify yet. And if it ever does go on the streaming, like I think I might, like I would like to have enough rappers on it where I can just make it like, okay, you know, this is the one track, but it's like 10 different rappers, right? Each song or whatever, you know, like kind of like in reggae too, you know, like they'll have that rhythm that you always hear, you know, like, and mad different people have been on the same, either like it sounds different, like lo-fi, normal fi, whatever, but it's that same beat and everyone got on it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I feel like, with electronic music, it's kind of like a badge to get remixes to get features. So it's mm-hmm. always really important for the music to be used by others. It requires mm-hmm. other people to share it for it to really feel right. promoted. And that's kind of the interesting and beautiful thing about electronic music.
Mm-hmm. And then because the music that we like, the hip hop, like coming in from hip hop, like I like hip hop a lot for the fact that I feel like out of any genre, it's probably the most dialectical because of the fact that we have to sample. So everything is coming from something, right? So, so now for my music to be getting passed around the same way that samples got passed around, the funky drummers got passed around and incorporated into drum and bass, incorporated into this, incorporated into jungle, da-da-da, hip-hop. All that came from something, right? So then it just, back to the centrifuge idea, just these things that are all together spinning around each other, bumping into each other, like nothing is in a vacuum, right? So that's how I feel about hip-hop at the end of the day.
Nice. Have you ever DJed, performed live in your, I think 18-year career? That's crazy.
Yeah. I don't even believe it sometimes. I'm like, dude, like the idea of that, so I'm 30, but I've been doing it for multiple decades while still young is crazy to me too. But playing out, yeah, man. I've honestly... My first show was in 2009. I was 17. Trash. And it's good because, it's your first show. It should be the worst show of your life, realistically. But it kind of taught me, this is what I don't need to do, right? This is what I'll never do. So that was good. Dude, low-key, it was so bad. There's people on you, there's YouTube comments where, yo, that shit sucked. So then I took some time off. And, at that time, all I was playing with, really, I just played with my laptop. And I just played, I went in, I opened Fruity Loops, and then I had, FUBAR. So I was going to try to, segue in between, I am DJing, but I couldn't get it right. So then later on, I finally get an MPC 1000. And then I started 2013 is the second show. And I played the MPC, and then I played beats off of the laptop as well. So then it sounds like I'm DJing. And then because as well on the MPC, you can sequence things. And you can mute and unmute tracks, so then it just adds more to the atmosphere. And then I got an SP-404 with that, it's just gunshots, laser beams, explosions, things that to make it seem like a DJ party. When you're listening to the Funk Flex mixtapes, you're listening to the DJ Clue mixtapes, and they just be screaming and going crazy, right? That's that hype, that's what I want, I want that feeling when people are like, yeah, I'm at an event, So that's another thing too. Now, as I'm getting older, I'm not really making music for notes, melodies, or sounds. I'm really making it for events. Not party events, but I want it to sound like an event. I want it to sound like something's happening. So it almost becomes it takes you somewhere, and it's almost more meditative in that way. You can exit from reality, a small departure, because it sounds like you're in another world in a way, and then you come back. So that's really the sound that's how it is in live shows. As far as hardcore DJing, real DJing, you're playing other people's musics and things like that, bars, clubs, and stuff like that. Not so much, man. Funny enough, last week or so, when I was in LA, I was at a party, and that was the first time I got on the little DJ joints with the flash drives and stuff. It was the first time I practiced virtual DJ on the computer, but that was the first time I was doing the thing. So that in itself, that's a whole nother, that's another growth and progress I gotta, and I'm looking forward to that too, just to keep me kind of young,
Okay. That's kind of crazy. A lot of your tracks, just like what you were saying at the beginning, how you were inspired by that kind of music being used as a soundtrack. Actually, your music could be used as soundtracks. Have you looked into that? Has somebody approached you for something like that? Or
I'm glad you asked. I did one time. I was like, I got me and my boy, we got commissioned to do a score for a documentary. It's called Control. And the director, Chris Bravo, basically the story is it's about a guy, it's about a kid, he was maybe 18, 17, and he gets wrongly accused for a crime. And then you watch the whole thing, you know, the way he gets ping-ponged around with the whole justice system and all of that. And it felt good. It felt good to kind of like contribute my music to something that was, you know, like a serious situation. And it's on YouTube, and you could probably see it on Vimeo as well. It's called Control. And that's like my first one and only real, like, true, like, you know, commission stuff. Also, too, like, there was this one site called Free Music Archive. I linked up with them back in 2010. I gave them just two albums. And because of, like, you know, the Creative Commons and stuff like that, people are always just taking it and making videos. There was even, like, I forget where in South Africa, which country it was, but there was, like, they made a PSA with it, like to use condoms and stuff like that. You know what I mean? Like, so it's cool to see, like, yeah, like, you know, as like, just as long as this thing can kind of take a life of its own, provide some message that kind of improves, like, you know, society, your environment, etc. Like, I'm pretty cool with that, you know? So I'm always been, like, I'm always open for just combining, like, visual and sound.
That's great. It's great that your music is now worldwide. It's worldwide and the continent has recognized you. Yeah. My brother, he went to the continent to play. And once the continent recognizes you, you get amazing amount of love. Like, he played in Tanzania and it was a huge, huge show.
So, that's lovely, yeah. Dude. And that's another goal of mine too. Like, I want to, you know, of course, you know, Caribbean background, and I'm, you know, I'm heavy into it. My older uncle, whatever, I'm like, you know how you have, like, it's like your dad's cousin, but he's your uncle, whatever. So he was actually in a band called Ebo Combo. He played the drums for that band. And so he played in a compa band. And that's, I grew up around that. And that's basically like, it's like Haitian jazz and funk at the same time, with a lot of percussion stuff too. And the other thing I want to kind of do, I want to get this, like, you know, hip hop experimental stuff to the Caribbean as well. You know, like, because, like, I think, like, you know, a child growing up in Haiti, like, oh yeah, he just knows compa. And maybe the popular American stuff as well, because sometimes you kind of hear a little, like, compa fusion with, like, popular American stuff. But just be like, yeah, you know, like, yo, you can also do this too. Like, you know, it doesn't have to be so, like, only this type of sound. Because that was another thing, like, growing up, telling my family, yeah, I'm making music, they think I'm going to be doing Mozart. They think I'm going to be playing Miles Davis. But then I'm doing, like, these weird-ass beats, and they're just like, this isn't music? No, it's nothing you've heard before, but everything is music, bro. You know what I mean? So expand that. Like, you know, I want to see more. Like, we should be experimenting more. We should be kind of just pushing it. Like, I really think we should, like, at the end of the day, people should be like, what the hell is a genre? You know, like, I really feel like it should be at that level. Like, no, I just like listening to sounds. Like, I like listening to, like, either, you know, major keys, major chords. Like, you know, I like optimistic sounds, or I like cryptic sounds. So, because then that kind of opens it up, because then it could be hip hop, or it can be rock, it could be jazz, because everyone has different tones and different emotions. So that we don't have this, you know, we don't have so much of this, like, I guess somewhat dogma to it. Like, I think sometimes people are like, oh, I don't like country, or I don't like this, I don't listen to that. But all these sounds, bro, like, that's really it. You know, it just sounds to me.
Integrating music is actually what I argue is part of Western proletarian culture. We take influences from around the world and put them together to make something. Mm-hmm.
So, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So you're definitely absolutely following the spirit of that.
Yeah.
So how do you feel your career is going overall in your 18-year career?
I've always told myself I'm as big as I am, you know, because it's easy. Like, oh, okay, why don't I have 1,000 followers? Why don't I have 15K? Why am I not on the cover of this magazine? How come this festival didn't hit me up? And yeah, you can always, and then that's going to just destroy what you do. You know, then it's going to take away, and it's also going to take away, because there's some genuine connections here. You know, it's going to take away from that. Like, it got to a point, anytime I traveled was because I knew someone who liked my music, and they're like, oh yeah, you can crash or whatever, or do you want to come play or whatever. Like, I was always like traveling under my, like, you know, under Black Ant, like under the music alias. So like, it gave me this like double life, you know? And I was like, yeah, cool, man, this is awesome. So that by saying, oh, well, I don't have 1 million followers and this and that, I'm completely like just taking away from all my history. You know what I'm trying to say? Like, I'm like, you know, belittling it. So I feel like my career is where I am. You know, if I'm feeling good, if I'm feeling great, yeah, of course. Like, you know, and then it just keeps going. You just got to stay consistent. You just got to keep doing it. you know, I'm blessed that, like, still right now, like, I can still release music that I made when I was like 16, 17 years old. And people are like, yo, this is crazy. Like, so it's like, it's still going, it's still moving, you know? So, yeah.
That's great. Before Pigeon Coop comes out next, is there one last final message that you want to give to our Canadian audience, North American audience? Because it turns out, yeah, I am getting a few listeners from America too. So
nice. Man, like, whatever. Whatever you want to do, just do it. Like, if you got a good feeling that you can't shake off, straight up, it's probably a good thing. Like, everything that we do is to survive, right? Like, the way our body, the muscles, our brain, blood, da, 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 all that is so we can survive. So why are you gonna, you're not gonna set yourself up for failure. You know what I'm trying to say? So if you got a feeling like, oh, I think I'll be good at making beats, because that's all it really was too. Like, when my friend said, yeah, you know, maybe you should make beats, I was like, low key, I think I could, like, I really feel like I have a good feeling about it. Like, I'm like, I don't know what it is, but I feel it. So let's go for it. Chances are, like, yeah, that's probably low key on some crazy whatever, whatever. That could be the future you coming back and telling you, yeah, bro, like, you got to be over there. Like, let's get over there. So just go for it. And then, and especially with art, music, you got to crack that first egg. Like, don't worry about that first beat. Don't worry about that first verse being garbage. It's low key, make it the worst. Make it the worst. Because that means everything else is better. You know what I'm saying? So then just keep on, like, just keep on fine tuning. That's all it really is. Just adding 1% more to something, and then you'll eventually get to the 100, you know?
That's great. That's a great message for everybody. So this is Black Ant. The song coming up next is going to be from Black Ant as well. It's called Pigeon Coop. So listen to that during the intermission, and we'll be right back.
Yeah, now, down. Look, down, suck your life, you're the guy I'll be mad to be. I put more bars and rappers than a chocolate factory. Fuck the name of bitch, y'all can call me Hell Son. I'm so raw, make everything a freezer look well done. I got homies that will back me up for miles and acres, while your crew got more squares than grid paper. I'm so damn ill, I get nauseous when I spit it. You hear what I'm saying, but you start coughing when you get it. Take all the happy shit right back to your grandma's, cause your ass will get robbed more than a store with no cameras. Fuck your wax shit, I'm bringing y'all the truth. I'm like Clark Kent, I transform in the booth. And if you don't like me, it's good, I understand. Cause I don't need a radio to have 99 jams. All I need is a fresh beat for my nigga Black Yan. And I'll show you how he can rip it better than I can. I'll blaze every track, I'll make your finger hit the rewind. I'm the reason why the bottom of my CD shine. Now before I leave, I need to say something towards you. The only way you get a hit record is if I smacked it for you.
Hello and welcome back to Socially Radical Guitarist. The song you heard just now was from our previous guest, Black Ant, and it's called Pigeon Coop. So a lot of interesting dynamics going on there with the music. It really goes to show that he's really had that grunge underground trip-hop influence. Very creative with how he writes. I mean, even getting a score for a documentary, that shows his artistic talent in many ways, and it should be appreciated a lot more. And I hope that putting it out here will do that. Now, you know, he didn't really get into his background a lot. When I was asking him earlier, you know, in the interview, like what kind of questions he was comfortable at answering, I mean, he said he didn't want to get too much into the politics because he wasn't that versed in it. But he does have a radical stance. He does have a radical stance, and I feel that's probably why he felt welcome on the show and why he's done documentaries like that for such socially conscious, why he shows that he's socially conscious by doing such a documentary. We'll go into the fact that he's Haitian. And, you know, I spend pretty much the better half of every season, trashing the United States and trashing Canada. And I will continue to do that as long as colonialism is still going on. But I'm going to give Canada and the United States a little break. And let's talk about France. Let's talk about France. Because their vote for declaring that China was committing a genocide. Obviously, it's complete nonsense. There's no basis for any of that. The U.S. can't find... none of their lawyers can find any evidence. It's just the imagination of an anti-communist, hyper-religious zealot named Adrian Zent. That's all where it comes from. Just him talking to eight people in exile who basically taken cash from the CIA. And that's it. That's all the evidence is. There's nothing, no real basis for any of it. But there are underlying geopolitical considerations for what the French did when maybe about 400 or so MPs absented, and about everybody that was there basically voted in favor of declaring that China was committing a genocide. And yeah, just want to let you know, the only ones making these accusations are European countries. No Arab countries are really making that accusation. They're declaring against it. And in fact, the UN quite recently issued out a statement declaring that this accusation was false. So there's no basis for it. But, you know, they did it. They made that declaration. And there's a reason why it's only really European countries and why France in particular wanted to clamp down on the Chinese genocide. We'll talk about the geopolitical considerations with what China is doing in Africa versus what France is doing in Africa. And what France has done to the African state, Haiti. As far as I'm concerned, it is an African state. If the Haitians feel themselves to be African, liberated themselves under the premise that they were African, and have even sought membership in the African Union, they're African. The African Union Commission that made that nonsense declaration that Haitians are not African, and then the AU saying they're not African, and then at the same time giving observer status to Israel. Israel. I you know, made a joke online, but quite honestly, I'm serious. It was only a half joke. I'm actually serious. That the bank accounts of Moussa Faki, the AU chair or commissioner, whatever he is, and the and Nana Akufo-Addo, the president of Ghana, because they're the ones that put forward that petition and approved it. Those two's bank accounts should definitely be checked. Somebody's got to look into their bank accounts and just see what's going on. Although I suspect that if you check what's going on with their bank accounts and then you do it to those two, you have to check everybody. And I'm guessing if you check everybody in the economic community of West African states and you check the bank accounts of everybody senior in the African Union, especially, you know, these House Negro heads of state, I mean, you're going to find a lot of problems everywhere. And that's the underlying consequence of not having unified a unified revolutionary orientation throughout the continent. But no, that uprising is happening. It's going to happen sooner or later. The movements are there. The groundwork has been laid. And what China is doing to support that, incidentally, which is part of the geopolitical consideration and part of why France is hostile to what China is doing, is that they are tailoring infrastructure, partly at the mostly at the request of these African states, to create a free trade corridor and to unify the economy of Africa. So once the economy is unified, then workers from different states will begin to interact with each other more. There's a very important statement from Julius Malema when they were dealing with the foreigners issue, where he had actually said, the unity of the continent will start on the shop floor. And that's the underlying mission of what's going on. A lot of these countries were segregated in their economies and weren't really unified. And that was part of the reason why you had revolutionary movements coming out in splinters. And then after an uprising or an attempt to seize power, the state was weak. And it could be easily isolated either by sanctions or just outright overthrown quite easily with very few soldiers or counter-revolutionary elements coming in. Because these states are incredibly carved up in that way. I mean, if you look at the Democratic Republic of Congo, the border makes absolutely no sense other than for resource extraction. There's a tiny little sliver of land on the west end in order that reaches the ocean. That's what it's for. It's to hell with the people, take the minerals, get out. And that's the paradigm upon which it operates. So it's absolutely incredibly important that we see Haiti as an African state, and we see the Caribbean, much of the Caribbean, especially Barbados, that at least got independence from the Queen. There's a lot of Caribbean states that need to begin to do that, but Barbados has done it. So, but yes, like that's the dynamic. And you see France right now, there's a billionaire that owns several ports on the west end of Africa. And that's from these post-colonial agreements that the bourgeois nationalists that took over and later revealed themselves to be absolute house Negroes signed on to, where they still hand over the resources and hand over sovereign parts of the country, like their gold, money, financial reserves, and yes, the basic minerals. A lot of the gold reserves from Ghana are in France and in European countries. Like this is what they've done, what the bourgeois nationalists have done, particularly in the north, west and central part of Africa. Leaders that were somewhat principled, independent, but you know, weren't communist, fell quite easily victim. One would imagine what would happen if Patrice Lumumba, for example, wasn't wavering and was far more militant and had a far more powerful base, a militant working class base in seizing, you know, the Democratic Republic of Congo and making a point to seize the minerals and to declare themselves a communist and to forcefully ally themselves with the socialist revolution that was ongoing. But that is what we see. That's the dynamic we see. And you know, Haiti's been subjugated pretty badly. They as soon as they took power, they were punished for it by France with the threat of invasion, and they extorted around $21 billion in today's currency out of Haiti. That wealth was forcibly extracted. From here on in, Europeans, Americans, I know I said it wouldn't dunk on Americans, but you did Haiti too, especially the Clintons. So that's basically the dynamics, and that's the underlying situation. It's great to see more Africans getting more conscious, more militant, and beautiful revolutionary movements forming. It's a shame to see you know, house Negroes like Moussa Faki and Akufo Addo, you know, betraying the Palestinian cause, betraying Arabs in Africa, betraying, you know, our brothers and sisters in the northern part of Africa, essentially, in the name of appeasing the West, going to the summit for democracy. I mean, wow. Embarrassing. And then, of course, the President Felix of the DRC does the same thing. But those are the dynamics. And a concerted, organized, continent-wide revolutionary movement is forming. It's the basis for which I'm optimistic. And eventually, one day, Haiti is going to be a member of the African Union, and it's going to be considered part of Africa, just like the rest of the Caribbean, because that's Africa, without a doubt. Sovereignty should be on an African basis, not on a Haitian basis. And Haiti does see themselves as African. A united continent and united Caribbean. That's what Africa should be. And that is what France is trying to stop. That's their biggest problem. Because China has done infrastructure developments for Haiti as well. And it's been helpful, particularly on their ports. A lot was made about Kenya losing their port, but they never lost their port. Meanwhile, African leaders on the West End have sold off their ports to a billionaire in France. And nothing is said about that. And these hypocrites, especially the socialists, the so-called socialists, declaring that there's a genocide in Xinjiang, which is really basically just the CIA whining, and, you know, with the help of radical anti-communists and the victims of communism, these individuals just whining about the fact that the right-wing Islamist coup that they tried to instigate in Xinjiang failed. That's basically what that is. It was a coup attempt. The attacks, the terrorist attacks, this declaration of the ETIM being some sort of freedom fighter or some sort of a movement for democracy. It was originally called the East Turkestan Islamic Movement. And the word East Turkestan, there's so much abuse of it. Because the original East Turkestan was a communist movement. It was a revolutionary communist movement. And that is exactly why when the communists took over, the leader of East Turkestan immediately signed on and joined the People's Republic of China. Because that's what it was actually about. And when the Kuomintang was still in power, the Soviet Union was supporting it. And when the People's Republic of China took power, they immediately integrated themselves with the People's Republic of China on a voluntary basis. And from there on in, there was no problem until the 80s when after, you know, 30 years of experimenting using radical Islam as a buffer against communism. And this is always the central underlying basis for everything that goes on. Because of that Cold War, what it was all about, it was about undermining communism, because communism was the central answer, the central weapon being used against colonialism and neocolonialism. So radical Islam became the buffer. It was a tried and tested experiment in Saudi Arabia, for example, when they got that monarchist king in there. And it also began to be used against the Soviet Union in Afghanistan, that region, which incidentally has a border with China. So in the 80s, that's when this problem started. And granted, yeah, the Soviet Union didn't help themselves with what they did there. You know, taking a side in a factional battle and shooting a president, that was not a good idea. But, you know, I argue infiltration was the underlying issue with what happened with the Soviet Union. But that's where it all began. That's the underlying thing. And that's the thing that I want Africans to see, that most revolutionary Marxists of an African persuasion want the masses to see, is that we want people to understand that the thing they're trying to stop is the communist revolution. And that's what they've been consistently trying to stop from the very beginning. So it is communism that should be the basis upon which we revolt, and it should also be the basis on which Africa unifies and upon which Haiti truly and deservedly gets its independence and gets reclaimed and gets returned to Africa. And that's my piece. And in celebrating African music, we're going to end the show with a great track from Heavy K and his album Respect the Drum Boss 2021. The song is called Lavo. So enjoy Lavo from Heavy K after the outro, and that'll be it. We'll see you next week. Thank you.
Socially.